The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Mark.
Glory to you, Lord.
Some Sadducees who say there is no resurrection came to Jesus and put this question to him, saying, Teacher, Moses wrote for us, if someone's brother dies, leaving a wife but no child, his brother must take the wife and raise up descendants for his brother. Now, there were seven brothers. The first married a woman and died, leaving no descendants. So the second brother married her and died, leaving no descendants. And the third likewise. And all seven left no descendants. Last of all, the woman died. At the resurrection, when they arise, whose wife will she be? For all seven had been married to her. And Jesus said to them, Are you not misled because you do not know the scriptures nor the power of God? When they rise from the dead, they neither marry nor are given in marriage, but they are like angels in heaven. As for the dead being raised, have you not read in the book of Moses, in the passage about the bush, how God told him, I am the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. He is not the God of the dead, but of the living. You are greatly misled. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
One form of idolatry that I think is especially pernicious for religious people who believe that they are on the right track, sort of like the Sadducees were, is anthropomorphizing God. And of course, the problem is that we cannot conceive of anything that we can't in some way grasp and sort of get our mental arms around, and that means we have to humanize God in order to have an understanding, which God realized, so that's why he became flesh and made his dwelling among us, the second person of the Trinity. And yet, so very often that doesn't seem to be enough for us. We want to pull God down to our level as much as God, through Christ, wants to lift us up to God's level. And I think we've got a prime example of this, recognizing in this gospel that marriage was not seen as a relationship of self-fulfillment the way that we so often do now. You know, you fall in love with somebody and it feels good to me and I'll be good to them because they'll be good to me and we'll get a lot of pleasure out of it and who cares about anything else and all of that kind of stuff. I think it's important to see that, you know, they were asking a very, very real question, but it was a very earthbound question, because marriage was for the purpose of continuing our family line, continuing to be present in our world even after you die through your children. And let's face it, what we have here is a very patriarchal view that the man's the important one and the woman kind of serves in relation to the man and leaves descendants, and that's what's important. And then God was seen as kind of serving that earthly reality. So what Jesus is simply saying is, you have to transcend that. That you can't make God after your own desires, after your own image and likeness, but recognize that God has made us after his image and likeness, and that the fulfillment of our life here is not just in perpetuating the human race here on earth, but it is in forming a community with God in heaven and in eternity, and that all this earthly reproduction and so on, life continuing and so on, you know, is meant to be the stepping stone, an important stepping stone, an important entryway, but nonetheless yields to something else. So basically idolatry means, as the Sadducees had this problem, making your God too small. God is always bigger than anything that we, any concept of him that we can create, even from revelation. God is always beyond that. So let's maybe go forth with joyful hearts, recognizing how great is this God whom we serve, and how on fire we may want to be, on how on fire he will make us to present his image in all that we say and do, calling people to union with God, calling them to community, the kind of community that will be fulfilled in eternity.